Hello friends, welcome to a new chapter today. In this chapter, let us now learn about the variations of placenta. Okay, so in the variations of placenta, we can have either a big placenta, which is called as placentomegaly, or we can have small placenta, that is, okay, small placenta. So big placenta or placentomegaly, it is seen in multiple pregnancies, diabetes mellitus, macrosomy, hydrops fetalis, where immune or non-immune hydrops fetalis, or syphilis due to inflammation and edema. In diabetes mellitus and macrosomy, there is increased chances of big fetus, right? So in order to provide more blood to the big fetus, there will be big placenta. You can remember like that. In multiple pregnancies, obviously there will be two babies. So in order to provide proper blood supply for two fetuses, we have placentomegaly. Then we have small placenta. Small placenta is seen in postdatism, intrauterine growth retardation, placental infarcts. Okay, then what is the most common variation of placenta? Most common variation of placenta is placental infarct, is the most common variation of placenta. Okay, next. Next we have something called as succinctate lobes or placenta. Succinctate lobe of placenta. So here, if you see, we have one placenta. There is one small lobe or accessory lobe which is attached to the placenta. Okay, there is one small accessory lobe that develop in membrane from the placenta at a distance from periphery of the main placenta. So if you see, in this succinctate lobe of placenta, you have one more lobe. So what are the features here? This lobe is retained in the uterus. Might be retained in the uterus, thus leading to missing lobe, or it can lead to secondary postpartum hemorrhage. When it is retained in the uterus, and if we did not try to remove it, then it can get infected, resulting in puerperal sepsis, or it can cause subinvolution of uterus. Sometimes this succinctate placenta is associated with placenta previa. Then during that time, it can cause dangerous fetal hemorrhage at the delivery. It can cause dangerous fetal hemorrhage at delivery. Here in this picture, you can see this small lobe of placenta which is seen. This is the main placenta. This is the small lobe. This is called a succinctate placenta. So it is more commonly missed in the, it can be missed after delivery, right? Then there is something called as placenta spuria. In placenta spuria, there is a separate cotyledon, and this cotyledon is not attached to the placenta. Then that is placenta spuria, where the cotyledon is not attached to the placenta, then we call it as placenta spuria. Okay, then we have one more type of placentas, the placentation, which is called as extracorial placentation. In this extracorial placentation, the chorionic plate is smaller than the decidual plate. So in extracorial placentation, we have two types. We have circumvallate. So this is circumvallate placenta, and if you see, this is circummarginate placenta. So what do you see here? Here in circumvallate placenta, you see a double fold of amnion and chorion. This is the double fold of amnion and chorion which you see, and this is the central depression which you see. So this is circumvallate placenta, where you see double fold of amnion and chorion, and it is associated with a central depression is seen. Whereas we also have one more type of placenta, which is called as circummarginate placenta. In circummarginate placenta, you see a single fold of amnion and chorion. This is the single fold of amnion and chorion is seen, and you see a margin is seen surrounding it. So that is circummarginate placenta. Okay, you'll see only one fold. Here you can see two folds. Okay, this is the difference. Both these circumvallate and circummarginate placenta belong to extracorial placentation. And here, these both will have increased risk of antepartum hemorrhage. These have increased risk of antepartum hemorrhage through placental obstruction or fetal hemorrhage. These can cause preterm delivery. Then these can also cause increased risk of perinatal mortality, fetal malformations, intrauterine growth retardation. So it's simple, because of the decreased blood supply, all these will occur. Okay, then. So this is circumvallate and circummarginate placenta. Then we have the next type of placentation is called as velamentous placenta. So in this velamentous placenta, the cord is attached to the fetal membranes. Here cord is attached to the fetal membranes. So here in this, instead of this cord should be attached to the to the placenta, right? But instead of that, it is attached to the membranes itself, amnion and chorion. That will lead to velamentous placenta. Because if the cord is attached to the membranes, it will cause increased risk of fetal hemorrhage. Because membranes are thin, they cannot hold the cord, right? And this is the only placentation which can cause fetal hemorrhage. The rest, all the placentations which we talked about, all those will cause maternal hemorrhage, and it is associated with vasa previa. Now, what is vasa previa? Vasa previa is a fetal, here it is a disorder in which the fetal membranes with the fetal vessels are traversing over the internal os. If you see here, the fetal vessels and the fetal membranes are towards the internal os. See, the head, between the head and the cervix, you have fetal vessels in between. That is called as vasa previa. Okay, here the main causes of vasa previa include, there can be velamentous insertion of placenta, succinturate lobe of placenta, placenta bilobata. All these can cause vasa previa. Velamentous placenta, succinturate lobe of placenta, and placenta bilobata can cause vasa previa. So diagnosis of vasa previa is transvaginal ultrasonography with Doppler. So if you do the treatment, for the treatment of this vasa previa, you will have to do a C-section, because whenever you try normal delivery, the placenta can cause can get infarcted, or it can cause increased bleeding actually, because this placental prolapse can happen and it can cause increased bleeding. Now the treatment of choice in this state is C-section should be done. Now, because we are talking about vasa previa, we should also know the differences, the test which we can do to differentiate feto-maternal hemorrhage. In vasa previa, we have fetal hemorrhage will happen. So in order to differentiate, we have two types of test available. One, we call it as apt test or alkaline denaturation. So in this, we add NaOH and blood. So when you add sodium hydroxide to blood, the fetal cells will remain, as they have HbF, which is resistant to NaOH. The hemoglobin F, which is seen in fetus, is resistant to NaOH. So as a result, the blood is not degraded. But if you see the maternal blood, it gets degraded, because HbA1 and A2 get degraded by NaOH. Okay, that is the qualitative test. But with that, you cannot measure the amount of bleeding that is going on. In order to measure the amount of bleeding, we have quantitative test to measure the feto-maternal hemorrhage. The quantitative test is called as Kleihauer-Betzke test. In this Kleihauer-Betzke test, we use two reagents, though we don't need to know the details. Here we use acid elution test and citric acid are used as reagents in this Kleihauer-Betzke test, right? Next, this is the normal placenta. This is placenta accreta, right? This is about the tests. Then we have to learn about the three different types of placenta that are important. These are called as morbidly adherent placenta. Why do we call them as morbidly adherent placenta? So in this morbidly adherent, normally if you see between the syncytiotropho, between the placenta and the attachment, you have attachment on the uterus, you have a membrane which is called as Nitta-Buch's membrane. But here in morbidly adherent placenta, this Nitta-Buch's membrane is absent. This Nitta-Buch's fibrinoid membrane is the condensation of, this is actually the condensation of syncytiotrophoblast. So this Nitta-Buch's membrane is absent. So because this Nitta-Buch's membrane is absent, there is also absence of decidua basalis. So because of that, there is no place for the placenta to get you know, embedded properly in the endometrium. Because of this absence of decidua basalis and this fibrinoid layer, that is Natabuch's membrane. So as a result, the placenta can directly go to the myometrium and attaches itself to the myometrium. Now, if the placenta is just attached to the myometrium, then we call it as placenta accreta. So in placenta accreta, it is just attached to the myometrium. It does not go inside. It is adherent. A for accreta. A for adherent to the myometrium. Okay. Then we have placenta increta. In placenta increta, the placenta will not just get attached, it will infiltrate or invades the myometrium. I for increta, I for infiltrates or invades the myometrium. Then we have placenta percreta. So this percreta will penetrate the myometrium to reach the perimetrium. So percreta, P for percreta, P for penetrating. So we have three types. One, we have placenta accreta, placenta increta, placenta percreta. So these are the three different types of morbidly adherent placenta. So here it is just attached, here it is going into the myometrium, in here it has already been penetrated and attached completely to the myometrium. So these are three different types of placenta, morbidly attached placenta. If you see what are the causes of this morbidly attached placenta, see, whenever there is no proper endometrium, whenever the endometrium has been lost due to some reason, that is one of the cause for this placenta, you know, morbidly adherent placenta. So it can be due to DNC or C-section, Asherman syndrome, myomectomy, or it can be due to placenta previa in current pregnancy, elderly or multigravida. See, in DNC, C-section, Asherman syndrome, myomectomy, if you see these causes, here there will be mainly endometrium has been destroyed, or there will be already there is some surgery or something going on in the endometrium, right? On the endometrium. So that has resulted in this placenta percreta. There is scar formation. To say there is scarring, in one way or the other, there is scarring in the uterus, okay, due to all these. So as a result, these have increased the chances of the placenta to get attached to the inside, you know, to get attached to the myometrium. Then the others like placenta previa, elderly and multigravida are also associated with this morbidly adherent placenta. Okay, then normally if you see, the placenta gets separated by a plane of placental separation, which is called as decidua spongiosum. Decidua spongiosum is a plane through which the placenta gets separated. But here there is no separation of placenta because it is attached to the myometrium, not to the endometrium. So because it is not attached to the myometrium, it is not attached to the endometrium, it is attached to the myometrium, it does not get separated easily. That will result in retained placenta. Whenever there is retained placenta, this will lead to postpartum hemorrhage. Now, what are the diagnosis? How are you going to diagnose it? Diagnosis by transvaginal ultrasonography, you see there is loss of, so there is loss of retroplacental translucent zone, which is normally present, and there are large placental lakes seen, and also the placenta to bladder serosa distance is equal to myometrial thickness less than 1 millimeter. You see, this is the picture which is seen. You see many transplacental large lakes. These are the large lakes which are seen. Okay, and you will see the placenta to bladder serosa distance, myometrial distance will be less than 1 millimeter. Okay, next. Then, but what is the investigation of choice? Investigation of choice for this placenta, morbidly adherent placenta, is MRI. Okay, then how are you going to treat it? Treatment is, you will have to do an elective lower segment cesarean section should be done. This elective lower segment cesarean section is done by senior obstetrician, and 4 units of packed cells cross matching and reserving should be done, and you will have to always make a uterine artery embolization with interventional radiologist to be available. because you know this is important. Uterine artery embolization with interventional radiologist should be made available. Then if it is, see, depending upon the type of the placenta, you will have to go through the surgery. See, if it is a placenta increta, you will have to do a classic cesarean section, should be done. If it is a placenta increta, you should go through classic cesarean section, and after cesarean section you should do a hysterectomy, okay, because we should not allow for next pregnancy. Okay, we should do a hysterectomy. Then we have one more thing, which is placenta accreta. In placenta accreta, you can do a lower segment cesarean section. Then after doing lower segment cesarean section, if the mother is multigravida, if she does not wish for any other any pregnancies, then you can do the hysterectomy. If the woman is primary gravida, then only you should remove the placenta, and then you should put an antibiotic coverage, and you should see the USG guided placenta up to follow up. You should see the USG guided placenta, and you will have to do a follow up. See, in placenta increta and percreta, if you see, the placenta has been attached deep into the myometrium, so it's almost impossible to remove only placenta. So as a result, you should do a classical cesarean section, remove the baby and remove the uterus, because even if you leave a small bit of placenta inside the uterus, that can get infected, leading to even more complications, and can even land the woman in septicemia. So because of that, you will do a hysterectomy. Okay, in placenta accreta, it is little loosely adherent when compared to placenta increta and percreta, and as a result, you can try at least give a chance for the uterus if it is primary gravida. If multigravida, you don't need to take that chance, and thus you can do a hysterectomy. Then we have something called placental infarction. Then the next lesion is placental infarction. This placental infarction is the most common placental lesion, which is associated with preeclampsia and lupus anticoagulant. It is the most common placental lesion associated with preeclampsia and lupus anticoagulant. In placental infarction, there is occlusion of decidual artery. This occlusion of decidual artery causes hemorrhage, and thus it can lead to abruption. Okay, that is placental infarction. Then we have the next, this is the type of placenta where placenta is attached at the margin, that is called as marginal placenta. Sometimes we have bilobed placenta where two placenta are attached to each other. See, this is the picture of fatal door placenta. If you see, this is the normal placenta. In normal placenta, you see it is attached from the center. See, in platel door placenta, it is attached at the margin. Okay, here placental attachment is at the margin. So that is battle door placenta. Okay, so thank you guys for watching my lecture. In the next class, we will learn about umbilical cord. Thank you.